brought to you by Social Impact Film Club, where you get access to amazing social impact films. I'm Shabu, your host, and today we have the award-winning filmmaker and fantastic storyteller, Mr. Worldwide with a Wild Side, and the director of Waiting for Mamu, the man himself, Thomas Morgan. So be sure to ask your questions in the comments and stay tuned for the trivia game with prizes up for grabs. But before he joins us, we have the trailer to Waiting for Mamu, which is now available on filmclub.sg. And membership to the club is actually free right now, so go and sign up, visit the site, join us at the club. Now, without further ado, I present to you Waiting for Mamu.
This amazing film is about one hero and how she transformed the lives of hundreds of children. Watch it now, and I promise you'll be moved, you'll laugh, you'll be entertained, and you'll be inspired.
I've seen a lot of shocking things in my time, but nothing as upsetting as the imprisonment of young children. And I've met some pretty amazing and brave people over the course of my career, but never anyone like Pushpa Basnett, CNN's 2012 Hero of the Year, who is fighting on behalf of these innocent children.
Namaste, welcome to our home.
Hello, Thomas.
Hey,
welcome
how are
to
you?
The club.
Thanks for having me.
Very glad to have you here with us today. Yes, okay, before we begin, maybe share with us a little about yourself and about the film Waiting for Mamu.
About myself. I'm a filmmaker I guess I kind of got into filmmaking to make films that I thought would make a difference. So, I've done several films, but all kind of have a purpose behind them. But Mamu was actually one of the early films that I did. I was actually finishing my first film, and then I met Pushpa in Charlotte, North Carolina, of all places, when she was here trying to figure out if she could make a connection to some U.S. Nonprofits to be able to support her business. And so I met her and she told me this incredible story. And, you know, at the time I was married with three kids and I had a film kind of underway and we were struggling a little bit. My wife said, "You're not starting that film until you finish the other." And I was like, "Well, I think we need to start this film." and so, I went to Nepal. We were kind of off to the races. So.
Awesome. As in, I know that you have a lot of interesting stories to tell, and we'll get into all of that later. But first, yes, I see that Hussein has joined us, and he says, "Hey, Thomas." So Hussein has been a great supporter of Air Amber over the years, and a close nice. Friend of mine as well. Okay.
Nice.
Before we get into the conversation proper, I'd like to ask the first trivia question. So we're going to do it a little different today. I'll be asking three questions, and these three questions will be asked as we go along the episode, right? Okay, so the first question, simple. If you've watched the film Waiting for Mamu on filmclub.sg, you would know the first part to this answer, but I guess you could just do a quick Google search. So here goes. The first question is, what award did Pushpa, aka Mamu, win in 2012 and 2016 respectively? Right? So as we wait for the answers, I'll just share a little about the prize that our lucky winners will win today. It is actually a book titled Little Mimi's Magic Eyes. And this is actually part of a series called The Butterfly Books. And these books were written and illustrated by the community of children and the youth in the community in Nepal. It was an amazing process, and it was an absolute privilege that I had to work on these books together with them. So you can also check out the books at our website at airamber.com. So yes, the three lucky winners will win this book. And as we wait for answers, I'm sure some of the people who are on are frantically trying to search for it on Google. Okay, so Hussein says CNN Hero Award. So Hussein, like last week, you got half the answer right. Yes, Pushpa won the CNN Hero Award in 2012. What award did she win in 2016?
Superhero.
Yes. Okay, we have the right answer. So Pushpa won two awards, the first being the CNN Hero of the Year. And amazingly, what CNN did was to have to celebrate a decade of different heroes doing social impact work and environmental work. Pushpa was the winner of that superhero award. So kudos to her. That's a bit of an update as well, post-film, for those of you who have watched it. Thank you so much, Shalini. We'll be contacting you for the prize. Okay, now that we've asked the audience the first trivia question, I have some questions for you, Thomas. So this is my quick fire segment for you, right? So the first one, here goes. What's your favorite Singaporean food?
Oh, you know, I think it's just chicken rice. I think, like, you know, we try to find it here, we can't find the same here. But I mean, it seems so simple, but yeah, it's so like delicious, and that's the one thing I miss.
Awesome, man. Maybe you should start a business there, right? A chicken rice business, Hainanese chicken rice.
I got enough going on, Shaw. I don't need business.
And yes, actually,
you can start it.
Yeah, Thomas is joining us from the U.S. in Utah, right?
Yeah.
Is that right?
So that's why I'm drinking coffee. Everybody else is drinking something else.
He came on for a technical rehearsal earlier, and the sun wasn't up yet.
Yeah.
What's the time right now?
It's 6:30 my time now, 6:30 a.m. So I came on at, 5:30 a.m., yeah. So
well, you're an early riser, so this shouldn't be an issue, right? Not a problem. Okay, yeah. on to my second question. If you could choose one song to play every time you walked into a room for the rest of your life, song would you choose and why?
I think I'd play the Rocky theme song.
Nice. Solid choice.
Because I think like that's like my favorite film of all time, the original Rocky. And I think it also in my mind is kind of like this, it's the theme song of an underdog, you know, it's like the theme song of like hope, you know, like you know what I mean? It's like battling for all things good in that movie. So I think like it always resonates with me, and my kids learn to play it like on the recorder and stuff. So like I hear it all the time.
Nice. Here we go, Thomas. It's your time to shine.
That's it, man. That's it.
That's a really good intro. Like if I were a WWE wrestler, like that would be my intro song for sure.
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly.
Okay, and on to my last question. Can you describe your life in a 6-word sentence?
Oh my God. How many words?
6 words in 6 words.
Oh, can I do it or less?
Or less is fine.
I would just say from unremarkable. Yeah, I think from unremarkable to quite remarkable would be the way I describe my life. But just like fascinating, like really like fascinating.
Yeah, so from unremarkable to quite remarkable. Did I get
it
right?
You know, I think, yeah? I think, you know, the first part of my life I spent really focused on me.
Yeah.
I think, you know, you spend your time trying to figure out how you're going to make your way. And it's almost like when you take your mind off of that and you kind of observe how you can influence and change the lives of other people around you, your life becomes remarkable. Life becomes like it's so much more fascinating and interesting because you see a world that's so much bigger than you and so much more vast. And then you kind of start to recognize that all of these things that you worried about in that first part of your life were simply not very important, you know. And now all of a sudden you're like, wow, look at these are people who are fighting for their lives. I mean, these are people who are trying to eat. These are people who are trying to survive, you know. And all of your little issues around this, that, or the other become, you know, quite minimal.
Yeah, your own life is, you've led quite a storied life, I must say. And I feel that someone should make a documentary of you, like the life of Thomas Morgan, right? And that, you know, I guess
I've
that could be the title of the movie.
I've heard
the
this
title
a lot
of the
times,
film.
That person's not going to be me.
I could just see it, man. The title of the film being from unremarkable to quite remarkable.
Yeah. Okay.
There we go. We got
you
a
know
title
what?
Right there.
Bring the cameras over, Shai. You can just start following me around.
Well, once the borders open, we'll make our way to
yes
to Utah in the U.S. And yeah, and you were saying right before we went live that you're going to take us fly fishing, right?
Yeah, I just learned how last night, so I'm almost a pro.
Awesome. Okay, so back to this life that you've led. Right? You've come quite some way. I mean, currently you're a seasoned documentary filmmaker. You've won multiple awards. You've worked with celebrities like Susan Sarandon, which is amazing. And I mean, that really exemplifies the quote that you just gave right there about being unremarkable and then transitioning to being remarkable. I came across an article by Variety, which you were featured, and the headline was "Ex-Banker Turns to Famous Friends to Make Social Justice Films." So my question is, what made you make that leap from being in the finance industry to then of a filmmaker? You had no experience in filmmaking or no educational experience on that front. So yeah, what made you do it? Why make documentaries?
So I always wanted to be a filmmaker. When I grew up, and my father just thought that was ridiculous. Like, you're not going to go to school for filmmaking. Like, you know, his quote, which I think I've heard this quote before. His quote was, people like us don't do things like that. You know, like that was like, it was just not who, you know, where we came from. We were a very blue collar town. I don't think they have blue collar as much in Singapore, but we, like where I came from, they made cars, right? Everybody went to an assembly line and made cars. And so, you know, I always wanted to be in film. I always messed around with it. The worst beatings I took from my father was when I took his, we had a Polaroid camera. And so I was like, I would take my army men and I would move them and I would take a photo and then I'd move them a little more and I'd take a photo. Then I would take a photo of a caption, you know, and so I was trying to make a film out of the, and I used all of his film. And the film when I was a kid was super expensive. It was super expensive. And I used
stop,
like 25,
some stop,
24,
stop motion animation.
Yeah, 24 photos that all I could do is just put them, you know, side by side. I couldn't really do anything with them. And he was so angry. But I think, you know, so then I came across the issue of homelessness much later. And basically my daughter was in school and I had gone to her school and I'd found out that there were four homeless kids in her school, in her class, not just in her school, in her class. And it was a time when, you know, there was a bit of an economic meltdown and people were struggling. And so, you know, I went home and I said, this is really crazy. And I was talking to my wife and I said, typically people are homeless because, right? And I named like four or five reasons why people are homeless. And my wife asked me, well, are you sure? And I was like, of course I'm sure, And so she kept kind of encouraging me to seek more information. And so I found some information from the National Coalition for the Homeless. And it was striking to me because it was not what I thought it was. And suddenly I was like this like epiphany, like these are people who were just like me until some point in their lives, and then something went terribly wrong. So I was in New York and I was there doing an investment bank deal for a really amazing guy named Malcolm Bricklin, which the deal never happened, but he invited me to a party. And when I got to the party, there was all of this paparazzi outside. And I said, what's with the paparazzi? And he said, well, rumor has it that my son dates Susan Sarandon because my son dates Susan
Oh,
Sarandon. Yeah, so
wow.
his name's Jonathan Bricklin. And so I went in, and honestly, like I didn't, it was all whole, it was an industry party. It was not really for guys like me. Again, like right in my father's words, people like us don't show up at things like that, So I was there and I was talking to this guy and, I said, somebody should do a documentary about homelessness. It's not what you think. And I started telling him all of this information and his simple response was, well, maybe you should do it. So I asked him, I said, are you in the industry? And he's like, yeah. And I said, what do you do? He says, I'm a documentary filmmaker. I said, anything I would have heard of. And he's like, supersize me. So, as Morgan Spurlock is standing there telling me I should make this film. And then Susan Sarandon walks over and Morgan says to Susan, hey, Thomas is going to make a documentary about homelessness in the United States. And she said, how can I help you? And I jokingly said, well, you can be EP maybe, or maybe do some voiceover. And she said, okay. And so I literally went home. I said to my wife, I want to quit my job. I want to downsize our entire life. I had three kids at the time. I said, I just want to go for it. And I mean, my youngest was 2 and a half. And she was like, yeah, let's go for it. And I was so shocked that she said yes. I said, are you sure? And she said, well, how are you going to tell your kids to chase their dreams if you don't chase yours? Let's just try it. So that was kind of it. Like then I started. And Susan's been a friend ever since, and Morgan's been a friend ever since. And somewhere along the way, Mary Louise Parker became a friend. And they were all supportive of the work that I was doing because they saw the intention behind the work. It was never like, it was always about like, you're going to do this so that this can happen, for people. And I think that's what
Yeah.
that really attracted them to the work. And Susan's been great. I mean, I'll see her next week in New York, and she's been unbelievably supportive for, over 12 years now. So it's pretty crazy.
Awesome. Well, help us say hi to Susan from the film
Yeah.
club in
I
Singapore.
will. Yeah.
Okay, anyway, well, we have a question right now from Hussein. Hey Thomas, I was wondering, as a social impact filmmaker, how do you remain objective while filming sensitive issues? This is an awesome question. Actually, I had a similar question, and it's this idea of like how do you tell stories of people in sometimes really unfortunate and vulnerable positions, but present them in a dignified way? How do you, yeah.
Well, I think, I always kind of go into it with the idea it's not my story. I just get to be there. It's their story, and I am there as an observer. My goal is always to show their life as they would see it, not as I would see it. And so everybody sees themselves in a dignified way. Everybody sees themselves, no matter how dirty, no matter how unfortunate, no matter how, insanely, dangerous the situations are, they still have a sense of, of pride and a sense of dignity that they carry. And so I try to show them in that light. In my films, very sometimes, but very rarely do you ever see or hear me. And that's because I don't want the film to be through the filter of me. Like Michael Moore is in front of the camera telling you what just happened, right? I don't want to be that guy because it's not my story. And so, and I'm not as good looking as Michael Moore. So
don't worry, Thomas. You're a handsome guy.
I always want it to be their authentic story, which actually makes it quite difficult. Because if you think about like the editing of this story of putting all of these pieces together, it's far easier if you can use your own voice or your own interview to kind of turn corners, right? To get from this part of the story to the next part of the story. But when you can't do that, when that's kind of off the table, you have to figure out like what is the scene or what is the piece. Or typically I try to use visuals in those moments, right? So I don't have to say it, I just have to show it, you know? And so I think the process is a bit longer, but I always am kind of checking myself to make sure that I'm not influencing the story, that I'm just taking the story in and kind of living in their moment, not in mine.
Well, I really like your style, or I guess your genre of documentaries, where it's narrative based, right? It's story based. It's based on a character. It doesn't come from the perspective of showcasing the issue at large, but it speaks to the issue at large through one character or one main character, which I feel is way more powerful when you're trying to convey a message, because there's so much information out there on the internet. You can simply Google and find all the facts and figures, but that is not, well, I'm not saying that that type of information is not important, but seldom does it actually change behavior, change mindsets. In my opinion, it is through that emotional connection.
I think we try to take very small stories to address very big issues, you know, like, so they're really, and I always like slice of life stories where we just enter at one point of a person's life and we exit at another, you know, and there's a journey in there that they take and we're with them in that point. But the reality is at the end of this journey, their life just continues. Like, there's nothing remarkable that happens so crazy, or, you know, I would say maybe with the exception of Pushpa with the CN and Hero work, but people don't, they just go back to work when we leave, you know, like they just go back to their lives. Like, that nothing crazy happens to them like that, that like suddenly you're allowed to be out of the refugee camp, or you're allowed to, you know, not be, you know, trying to get kids off prison floors, or, you know, none of that happens. So it's like, I feel very humbled that they let me step into their life in these moments. And I'm very thankful. And I feel a huge responsibility, because I mean, when you think about that, like I get to frame that portion of their life for really the rest of their life. It's on film. It doesn't go away. So how do I do that in a manner which tells their story? Maybe sometimes it's a bit abrasive, or maybe sometimes it's a bit unnerving for them, but in the truest form of that story. And I think that's the, you know, you see so much like junk that comes on now too. And I'm not saying I shouldn't say that, but like people, when my films are classified with like, what's the guy, Tiger King or whatever the dude is on Netflix or something. Right? I'm like, no, that's not the same. Like, this isn't the same. Like, I spent 2 years with this, you know, this person, and you're just going and kind of sensationalizing this weirdo with these tigers. Like, how can that be the same? So I take it very seriously.
Awesome. Okay, we have one more question here. What is your source of inspiration, and how do you decide which idea deserves more attention?
So I think I see myself a bit in each one of these characters. I see in each one of these subjects. I see, and that sounds strange when you're talking about a woman in a refugee camp, you know, like in Beirut, but they're all underdogs. They're all people who, you know, thought in their lives they would never have a voice, they would never be heard, they would, you know, they were just like, and so I think that's always my inspiration is like, that's how I felt, you know, that's who I was. I grew up in this blue collar town. I never thought I would have, you know, any celebrity friends or anything happen, you know. I really but how I choose them is pretty simple. Like, if I if I'm interested in a story, I can sit with somebody for literally 15 minutes. We wouldn't even have to speak. I could just tell you, yes, I can make a film about them, or no, I can't. You know, it almost is like how you feel when you're around them. There's some people that just have this energy that comes with, like, I don't know, because when you start, you're betting on that person. You know, you're really betting on that person to finish. You're betting on them to be successful in whatever way success is, even if success is in not accomplishing the mission, but with this pride and dignity of trying, you know. And so, and they have to let you into their life, but it's something about the energy about them. But I know that sounds so crazy, but they don't have to say a word. When I sat with Miriam, you know, I knew in 10 minutes that I could make a movie about her.
Yeah, I completely agree, because I've met Pushpa, I've met Miriam in Beirut as well, and they just have an aura about them, right? Yeah. And they are really strong characters. I guess some people could say stubborn, but as in when they're trying to achieve something, well, nothing's going to stop them, right? Like Miriam.
I also think, like, you can tell by the look on their face, they convey so much emotion and how they feel in that moment by their mannerisms. And I say all the time, just because a person has a great story doesn't mean that'll make a great film. You know, there's some people who just can't convey or don't have that thing that makes it very interesting on film, even though it's a really great story, right? That actually makes a great book or a podcast, but maybe not a great film.
Yeah, so, well, back to Shalini's question as well, right? Inspiration. You did share a little about how you got started. And I think that's really amazing that it kind of began with one conversation. One conversation that sort of pushed you over the edge.
Yeah. Right? I look back now and I really can't believe I did it. Seriously.
No, and it's quite amazing because I recall our first conversation. I think if I'm not wrong, we did it on Skype. Oh, it was some online platform.
Yeah, yeah.
My co-founder of Amber, Suraj, and myself, we were sitting in our office. I think we were Skyping with you, and you were in London at that point of time. And before anything else, beyond like the hello, how are you, small talk, I've clearly remember the first question you asked us, and that was, are you guys a secular organization?
Yes.
Are you guys a religious organization? Or you said we're completely secular, no religious affiliation whatsoever. And then what you said was, all right, we can work together. And it's quite amazing from that one conversation. I mean, we've worked and partnered together on so many different initiatives, from various filmmaking workshops to producing Sufra, to having that Asian premiere of Sufra in Singapore at the Capitol Theatre, which was amazing. And right now, with you and your company Square Zero Film as a partner for this film club, the Social Impact Film Club. So again, I mean, that's the power of conversation, right? Just that one conversation sparks an idea and it just branches off into so many other things.
Yep.
Amazing.
I agree.
But with another comment here from Hussein, with a lot of remarkable stories, how do you manage to spread your film's engagement and awareness? So I guess this speaks to your impact campaign for the films that you create, right? Like, what's your process? Like, maybe so if we bring it back to Waiting for Mamu, maybe my first question is, did you work on that strategic campaign as you were creating the film, or was it like after the fact?
No. So in the course of making the film, I always will find time to ask the subject of the film, like if you could have anything, you know, what would it be? Like, if you could do anything, what would it be? And what I find remarkable is, because these are the kind of people they are, it's always a very selfless ask, right? It's like, if I could have a house for these kids, you know, if I could build this house so that we don't have to move or get kicked out of these places, if I could build a school, even though I don't have any kids, if I could build a school inside this refugee camp, or if I could run camps for kids so that they could have an opportunity to see what college is and find a mentor or whatever, right? So it's always a very selfless thing. And it that becomes the goal for me. Like, okay, how do we do this? You know? And I think then we, from that point, I start thinking about how could we build a campaign? What does it look like? And then, you know, but I will say the great thing about film is once the film comes out, it's off to the races. Like I let other people, I would call our accomplices, I let them run with it. You know, like you come up with ways too, right? Like, let's come up with amazing ways to help. And so a great example is during Mamou, after we had the house about 70% completed in 2015, there was a horrible earthquake and we lost most of it. Most of it had to be redone. And I was devastated. We'd spent all this money. We'd raised all this money, hundreds of thousands of dollars to build it. And I just said, listen, I'm going to give the film away if you're willing to use it for some kind of fundraiser. I don't care if it's in your home with four people or if you have a whole, you know, whatever. And I just gave it out. Like, I left it to our accomplices. I left it to the audience to figure out how to do that. And I saw some of the most amazing things that would come in. Like, a barber played it in his barber shop all day and gave all the proceeds of haircuts that day to the house. Another woman had a yoga class that was give what you can class and played the movie before and then yoga after. And like, they came up with some of the most interesting and creative ways that fit who they were to give back to Pushpa and these kids. And it was remarkable. It was crazy. And you know, suddenly like we were building the house back and we had it built, and it was unbelievable. And I think that's it. It's not my campaign. It's the collective our campaign. Like, yeah. What are we gonna do? And I feel like that's the way the films are too, right? Like, I get to tell these stories. Like, I get to be the person, but at the end, I want people to feel like they can be involved. They can be part of it. Like, they can. If you go there and you see names on the side of Pushpa's house, these are people who have never been to Nepal. They don't know anything about the place, you know, but they were so enamored with her story. And when you see her, or when you see Miriam, or when you see Frank in this film I've got coming out, like, you, suddenly you're attracted in a way that you just want to help. Like, what do I do? You know? So I think that's it. It's more like just getting it out and letting people figure out how they can help. Sorry, that's a really long answer.
No, it's a good answer though, because it's amazing. And as you were speaking, I was just reflecting on our relationship with the community in Nepal and how our first partnership with you was to hold a screening of Waiting for Mamou in Singapore at the projector, which yep. We then raised some funds. We left to Nepal the next day. We got to meet the kids. We got to meet Pushpa. That friendship just grew. And that... Fast forward to a couple years back, we created a whole enterprise venture through the Butterfly Books together with the kids, right? So now it's essentially sort of like passing on, like Pushpa passing on the torch, right? A lot of the focus was on Pushpa through the film, but then now the kids are playing a much more active role in the work that they do for kids who are still in prisons in Nepal. But also having initiatives such as the Butterfly Books, where they get to express themselves, tell their own stories in a creative way. So that's really amazing.
But what I love too is like, I may leave that story, right? I have to move to the next film. I never leave the friendship. But at the same time, other people stay attached and keep helping. You know, they continue to support Pushpa. They continue to ask and be involved. And it's almost like, you know, like you're leaving a trail, you know, like this trail of people who continue to stay in their lives and to be helpful. And like, that's so cool to be like, I can't stay on one story forever. But it's like the fact that other people do, right? That other people stay engaged. And I, you know, I speak to Pushpa. We text back and forth all the time, but it's like, it's amazing to see how many people still ask about the story. How many, I mean, that film came out in 2013, you know, like, and people are still very connected to it. No doubt about it.
Awesome. I think we had a comment from Hussein. Basically, he was just giving you props for always being able to tell the underdog story.
It's my story. Good job, Thomas. Like, that's who I am. Yeah. That's
so
me.
Yeah, Thomas has a new documentary film themed around a rugby team, and I used to play rugby, so I'm really excited for that to come out. So for all of you who have not joined the film club, please visit filmclub.sg. This you will have the opportunity, most likely, if Thomas agrees. We're going to be screening that film about the rugby team, and it's a truly inspirational film. Right. Now, at this point, I will like to speak to the audience. Yes, on to our second trivia question, right? Let me just pull that up. Trivia, where you at? Okay. I mentioned this before, and you might have seen it if you search for Thomas, but this is the question. What is the name of Thomas's film company? Don't worry, Thomas didn't ask me to do a shameless plug for him.
I'm waiting to hear the answer.
Yeah, here we go.
That's actually, you know, you keep playing that song, that's actually not the right song.
That's IRL, right?
Right.
Well, I guess it's hype enough. Okay, do we have any answers from the audience? This is a fairly simple... that's incorrect. What is
so close.
The current... Yeah, so close. But what is the current name of Thomas's film company? David Gunn asked, what's Rebel House?
This one.
Yes, and we have a winner! Hussein, Square Zero Films. He wasn't too sure. He had a question mark at the end of his answer, but I'll give it to him. So congratulations, Hussein.
Great job.
Okay, now back to where we were at. Right, okay, so... Again, I want to bring it back to waiting for Mamu. Could you share what were some of the highlights you had, or maybe the lowlights, while you were making this film? Especially, dealing with kids in the community, right?
I think one of the, you know, you get there and you see the enthusiasm and the spirit of these kids with Pushpa, you know, and it's exciting, and you feel, I mean, you just feel like a such a great sense of family, and such a great like just even under these really unfortunate circumstances, you know, you just feel like there's just such hope, and she's just instilled like such a sense of like of hope in each one of them. And I think like that to me was really exciting, and it was fun, and then, you know, also to see the way that she's so young when we started the film, and like she was so organized, and she was so like, she had so much wisdom for somebody that was so young. You know, I remember one of the things that she said was, I said, you know, you have to pay to send kids to school in Nepal. And I said, well, do you get a, you know, with 50 kids in the school, do you get a discount? And she said, you could, but she said, I don't take the discount. And I said, well, why is that? She said, because when I go there with a problem, I want to be treated like every other parent, not like someone who is discounted to be in the school. And I was like, oh my God, that's so smart, you know? And so like all of those kind of things, but I think the hardest part, and where I really realized what this all meant, was when we went to the prison to pick up Driver and his sister, and being there and seeing the process and being in the prison, you know, like standing there. And we're not supposed to be filming, so I'm kind of filming on my phone. You see it kind of scratchy in the thing, but that's when it like struck me, like, wow, this isn't what we have back at the house, is not the reality of these kids, and it's not the reality of Pushpa too. Like, I mean, it's quite brave for this woman to walk into an all men's prison, you know, and be there to take these kids out, you know, and and to really kind of push back against some cultural norms in Nepal to be this strong woman.
She faced many challenges, right? Uphill tasks.
Yeah, yeah. But I think like that's really it's not only quite brave. I think you have to have some true conviction to continue doing that, you know? And so I think like that's the point where like the story really starts, because then you're like, how am I going to make people feel this, you know, this feeling inside this prison and what it's like to be here, you know? So I think that was really it. I mean, highs and lows.
Also, we have quite an interesting question here. Having spent time with Pushpa, what message do you want or do you have for parents? What message do you have for parents? Man. Have you learned anything from Pushpa as well in terms of parenting?
I don't know, man. I have four kids and it's a street fight every day, you know. It's I think more than anything that I've learned, and I think part of this is my own experience. Your kids are gonna kind of make their own way, right? With or without you. So like I wanted to be a filmmaker. My father said no, right? So I became a filmmaker much later in life, but I, you know, like just support their craziness. Like, why not? Like, I mean, if it's not harming you or harming them or whatever, like, I think we have this idea of what success looks like and we want our kids to follow in this, you know, we want it to be easy. We wanted them to follow in this way that just seems like it's very practical, you know? So when my 19-year-old son comes to me and says, Dad, you know, I'm going to my second year of university. After this year, I'm going to quit. I'm going to move to Vegas. I'm going to play professional poker. I'm like, amazing. Let's do it. You know, like he's studied, he's done all the work. He's, you know, he's willing to try. Like, how can I tell him no? dream? No, that's silly. You know, like it would sound just like my own father, you know? So I think it's in having those conversations where you do say like, hey, let's just make sure this and this and whatever, you know, like, but you don't obstruct them, because I think that's the thing that we all find, you know, when we look back on our lives, it's like, I wish I would have tried this or done this or whatever. And I think it's with the encouragement of a parent that, you know, you can try and fail. And I think that's the one thing in our society here, and definitely in the society in Singapore, failure should be looked at as an honor, a badge of honor, you know, like, because you tried something that was outside of whatever it was that, you know, but you were willing to try and you were willing to fail and learn and move on to the next thing. And all of those failures are experiences that will make you successful. And I think that's,
it builds character for sure, right?
Yeah, but I don't think, like, I think we've become a society where it's easier to laugh at people who have failed than to actually try something and fail ourselves, you know, like, and I don't know why that is.
You hit the nail right on the spot, because, through the Butterfly Books, I had also interviewed Pushpa. We created a video just to tell a short story about how the books came about. And that's what she essentially said, this idea of allowing the kids to explore their interests, explore their passions, wherever they may fail, it's a learning experience and that will get them on the right track eventually. But the idea is to just let them be kids, let them be who they are, right?
Make their own track. Yeah, they got to just make their own.
Blaze their own trail.
Right.
Yeah. Maybe could we pull up that video, Our Time to Shine, just so the audience members can have a sneak peek about the Butterfly Books process and also get to see Pushpa and some of the youth authors.
is the kid who has given the bond to this organization. I think we need to create an opportunity for each kid, you know, because each kid have their own individuality. Just create that opportunity so wherever they find their passion, you know, their interest.
Butterfly Nursery Kit is like for the children who are inside the prison, and then it includes like all the necessary like nursery stuffs. When like Amberg team came, I told about like we need a books for the children, and then as soon as I said why don't we like work together and do that.
Read our own story. It was quite new for me. It was so I think it will be hard for me because like I'm not used to write in English, but like for the sketching it really take a long time. So even like we used to work up at like 2 o'clock at night for the sketching. Oh man, I was so stressed, and not even only me, like everyone is so stressed. And then but we never give up.
I feel very proud because in my class also everyone knows I have read like study book, and I have never earned money with my struggle. In the world there is no person is dead, like nothing can do, because orphan children, orphan person also can do something for their life. So I feel proud.
This is a great opportunity to sign in front because it's the first time to write a book. My hope is for Butterfly Book to inspire to people and to the children who read my story.
So that is the story behind the Butterfly Book stories. Fun fact from the film, if you caught Biraj in this video, he was also featured in Waiting for Mamu. So in the community in Nepal, they actually, how they celebrate is to have a momo party. Momos are essentially Nepalese dumplings with like chicken fillings. And so Biraj holds the record for the most momos eaten, and that was 45. So that's a fun fact for you. In fact, that was in the film, that was in 2013. When I was there with the team, he actually could eat more than 50 momos. So that's quite an amazing feat. And with that, I have my last trivia question. So this question can only be answered if you have watched the film. And here goes. So when Lakshmi was asked the question, what do you want to be when you grow up, in the film, what were her three answers? Let's see, maybe let's take the next like 15 to 30 seconds. If anyone has watched it, I would be keen to see if anyone remembers this information. Thomas, do you remember?
I don't know if I can remember all three, and I made the film. I know I have two, but that's a hard trivia question, Shaw.
Well, I won't give it away, and we'll leave the audience members to write the answers. If there isn't anyone who can answer right now, we'll leave it open post this live session. But another more of an update about Lakshmi. So if you've watched the film, Lakshmi was one of the first few kids who was in the butterfly home. If you watched it, she had a lot of different aspirations of what she wanted to be when she grew up. But as an update, she recently just graduated from the top university in Nepal, which is Kathmandu University. She pursued her passion and interest in fine arts, and she came in top of the class. So kudos to you, Lakshmi, if you're watching. Keep up the great work. I know that one of Lakshmi's dreams is to start an arts therapy program for women in prisons. So that was interesting. We actually trialed one of her workshops or her sessions here in Singapore. Okay, so Hussein says doctor, teacher, photographer.
Close.
But no cigar. Hussein, you're always so close, but you didn't hit it right. Oh my gosh. Okay, Shirley.
Yes.
Social worker, photographer, and office receptionist. Yes, that is right. Congratulations. Awesome. Okay, thank you so much for participating in the trivia. We will have this trivia segment with every in real life episode. So please come on next week when we have our next. And finally, Thomas, before we wrap things up, hashtag real talk. What is your advice to our audience members in becoming a better human being and a better person?
Oh, I don't know. I think part of it is just, you know, getting outside of, you know, your own life and thinking outside of your own life and seeing the struggles of people around you. I think so many times there's, you know, we seem to argue to win, you know, and I think, you know, arguing should be to understand. And I think that's, you know, we've lost that sense of trying to understand people in our lives. So I think that's it. You know, I think that's just trying to really understand as opposed to judge.
Awesome. I actually, I found a quote on IMDb that you gave. And wait, by the way, this is the right song, right? This is your intro,
yeah, that's
right?
The right one. That's the right
yeah.
one.
Yeah. Okay, I came across this quote on IMDb. So here goes. If there isn't a chance I will be killed or arrested making the film, it probably isn't a film I am interested in making. So that's what you said, right?
That's right.
Can you... Okay. Sorry, this last request. What was your wildest experience that you've had in your filmmaking journey? Like, what was one incident that really stuck out?
Oh man, you know, I think there's so many. I was shot at in Chicago. We were locked down in Haiti.
Oh my god,
in Haiti for civil unrest right outside of our hotel. We machine gun fire when we were in Beirut. We had all lay on the ground inside the kitchen.
Crazy.
I mean, all those are crazy, but I think the most. I think the craziest and the most impactful is not that dangerous, which is really crazy. The film I'm making now that was coming out in August called Scrum, part of the film, which was unexpected, was kind of this father-son story and this misunderstanding of each other. They couldn't really, they didn't relate very well to each other. And I think like, through the film, actually, and in interviewing both of them and asking them all of these very candid and direct questions, I think made them reassess their relationship, you know, and I think it changed their relationship because they had to answer these questions and then they would hear their answers out loud, maybe for the first time. And so, like, I think it was a bit of a, I think it was cathartic and a bit of a healing in the process, which was for me like to feel like you're somehow being part of this, you know, and somehow it was like an interviewer / therapist, you know, like it was like this crazy, but I'd never experienced that before. I'd never had this experience where, you know, and then when the camera, like the looks on their faces when the camera was off afterwards was just, It was so interesting and inspiring. And
that's
it made
a whole
really feel the impact.
That's a whole nother layer of transforming lives through your documentaries, right? I think that
really
is really
crazy.
Amazing.
But I will say, you know, kind of going back to the other question you asked really quickly, the one saying that I live by, in fact, I've got it tattooed on my arm now, at least the first part, is be bold and mighty forces will come to your aid. Goethe is a philosopher and a poet in Germany, but that was his saying, be bold and mighty forces will come to your aid. And so I always feel like if I'm questioning whether or not I should do something, if it's for the good of somebody else or for the good of a cause that I think is important, like just be bold, right? People will come around you, and especially when they know you're doing it for the right reasons and you're doing it to help. And it's always happened. I mean, I've had some of the craziest stories of, like, you know, not having any money and suddenly a guy turns up and gives me money to help me pay my crew. Like, I've only met him 3 times and he wires money into my account and says, you know, just keep doing what you're doing. You're doing the right thing. You know, like, it's crazy stories. Incredible. But I feel like the universe kind of comes around you when you're, you know, you're on this mission and you're trying to do things that are right. And I think where we hesitate and we stop is in self-doubt, you know, and we don't think that people, I think, you know, believing in the goodness of man, people will come around. People do want to do good. They want to be part of a greater purpose, you know. So I think that's something I think that whenever I come to a fork in the road and I think I can do this is a safe way, or I could do this and I, you know, this is a bit more aggressive and may, you know, risky, I always take the risk, be bold, right? Like, just go for it.
Take the risky road. Awesome. That's amazing advice. I would like to thank you, Thomas, for joining us today. I had a really great time having this conversation with you and just reconnecting despite the whole COVID mess around the world. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you. I good to see you again. Good to speak to Siraj. I think I think film is a great way when you're locked down or when you're in a place where you can't spend much time together. Yep. It's a way to connect to the rest of the world, and I think this is a really amazing platform that you put together.
All of you heard Thomas, right? Join the film club, filmclub.sg. Let's go.
Yeah,
and
right.
Actually, Thomas let the cat out of the bag. I had purposefully left out the name or the title of the film, but since he said it, you heard it here first on In Real Life.
That's right.
In August, the Scrum, right? Scrum. Scrum will be dropping in August. So come on filmclub.sg and you get to watch a rugby-themed, impactful, powerful story that is Thomas's latest creation. So thank you again, Thomas.
The impact campaign for that film, it will be so different and so, like, especially in the US and hopefully there as well, like no one's ever seen before. In fact, people now are like, I can't believe you're doing it this way, but it'll be so, talk about bold, this has been the boldest. So I'm anxious to share it with you when it comes out.
All right, so all rugby fans, get on the platform right now, filmclub.sg.
Thank you,
everyone.
Thank you. Thank you.